the sheep.
Hop day, Guam, Billy Not Ready here, your local ninja warrior reporting live. I just want to encourage everybody to stay positive, stay active, stay healthy, stay smart, stay strong. Train your mind, your heart, your body, your soul, your spirit. Train, quarantine.
Did you know that it's true? Everything is possible. And shout and follow the stars. Forget about the past, that it's over. We are the young ones, our way is forward. Who keeps tabs on stupid mistakes? We all mess up, but that's just the way. We learn how to get back up. We learn how to turn the page.
Siju Usma Asi para Toru Ibida Niju, Nasafu Hamzu, and Siju Usam Benedisi.
Maraming salamat po.
Kalayan!
Thank you for all that you do.
Nihi Pogu, Tatafandanya Hit, Tatafanadahi Hit Motna.
Mujun Guse Gamsamnida.
Ufabot, Fanyaga Gigima Niju, Tatoru Hit, Tafansafu Motna.
Off the day. Thank you for joining me for this short, brief overview of our draft framework for school curriculum and distance learning programs offered by the Department of Education Curriculum and Instruction Division. Hopefully this guidance is timely, as we know that school is coming up and the board has just approved the August 17th return for students. So that, of course, doesn't leave us a lot of time. And schools are already in the works of designing their distance learning programs and supports for students and organizing their master schedules and whatnot. So hopefully what the information that we provided you today will contribute to your current work. The four items that I'll be discussing with you today have to do with this curriculum matrix that you see on the screen now. I don't have a PowerPoint presentation. I'm actually showing you the document that I'm sharing with all of the principals so that when you're looking through this presentation, you can actually reference the document itself and just go through the different pages. So no PowerPoint presentation here. The second item would be going over the lesson plan piece. And this is included in our regular training, but I just wanted to show you kind of the sample lesson plan design and different parts. It's designed to be very easy to use for for all folks, teachers, parents, and students. So I wanted to go over that a little bit with you and share with you some of my thoughts. The third item will be discussing some implementation activities based on the proficiency level of a teacher with regards to technology and online tools, depending on how comfortable they are with distance learning strategies. I wanted to offer some recommendations on how they can kind of phase in some of their efforts. And then lastly, kind of go through some activities that schools can do to prepare for the following school year. This includes a sample schedule for professional development, or not sample schedule, but kind of a sample set of activities for professional development and a sample first week of school when students do return. So with the curriculum matrix that you see here, let's see, let me try to move down. The curriculum matrix that you see here, many of you would really kind of connect to this immediately as kind of another format of what we call, under normal circumstances, our scope and sequence. Basically, it's just placing your kind of content across multiple weeks and across multiple content areas. In this case, it's designed more for elementary school, but you can do something similar for middle and high school, where you're just trying to clarify in each component what is being covered for that week, for that subject area. Now, we do plan to organize this and help coordinate this centrally. A lot of this is going to be based on the PSSTs that were just completed, the priority, standard, skills, and topics. And as we plug in the different PSSTs for each of the different content areas, we will definitely offer that to the schools and update this document. But as you prepare your curriculum at your school site and your work with your teachers, we invite you to work with within your PLCs for each of the content areas and grade levels and try to clarify what does your projected year look like. Right now, at this point, as of the recording of this video, we completed the PSSTs last week for kindergarten all the way through high school for the core content areas. And this week, we're working with the electives. So we're going to try and get those to you as quickly as possible. But they are a shortened, focused set of priority, standards, skills, and topics for all of the different courses that are being offered in the DOE. So if you were to map this out, you can have a clear understanding of what the entire curriculum looks like from the beginning to the end of the school year. I do want to point out a couple of things. First, we don't want to view this as something that's strict where you cannot make any changes. We know that kind of the idea is we want kind of a consistent sequence, but not a strict pacing guide. Because, again, a lot of this is, at this particular point is theoretical. We've never kind of implemented a curriculum like this with a large percentage of students who are online, a large percentage of students who are hard copy, or even students who are face-to-face, but on, kind of an alternating schedule. So our pacing experience in the past is kind of, out the window, right? We don't necessarily know how all of these different factors affect our pacing with our students. So the idea is, although we want to have a clear, consistent sequence that we are following, we really want the teachers and the schools to really focus on student achievement of these really important priority standards and don't worry too much about being fixed to a particular pace. This is something that we definitely want to put in the hands of the school and the hands of the teachers. So find the pace that works with a lot of these standards and content and feel free to adjust as needed. In fact, one of the things that I probably want to do is take out the first column where it says week one, week two, and so on, and maybe change that to more like unit or just PSST. So that way, you don't feel as though this is something you need to finish in week one or you need to finish in week two and so on. We really want you to assess your students on a regular basis, look at their progress, and really find the pace that seems to be right for your school and your students. And keep in mind that this might not even be class by class. Sometimes these are you know, based on individual students. So just like how we've said that a lot of this is going to require individual engagement on the part of the student and the parents, you know, sometimes this work is going to be differentiated. It's going to be different for every student, you know. So although you want to have some type of consistent pace for the entire class so that, you know, you're able to manage the entire group, a lot of it might also be very independent work because you're trying to accommodate the different challenges and the different kind of learning styles and learning pace that each student has. So this, you know, this document should at least help you with that general kind of monitoring of what is supposed to be covered for each content area and throughout the course of the quarter, semester, and eventually the year. So again, this is just kind of one example, and this is an example for elementary school. I think this was a third grade standard. In fact, just to let you know, that key ideas and details, that is actually a standard that goes all the way across from elementary school all the way up to high school. So, you know, keeping in mind that some of these standards are not taught just for a short period of time, some of these standards definitely expand throughout the entire year, and in some cases go on, continue on vertically. So, don't be kind of stuck based on the cells, because I know sometimes the cells kind of imply that all of these standards are either mutually exclusive or singular in terms of when they get covered. And sometimes, you know, we forget that they could actually be integrated, or they could actually be extended over a longer period of time. This three-part lesson format was part of the training, and I just wanted to kind of share with you again this piece. Again, you can add to this. You can definitely add to this. Our intent here is not to stifle your creativity or mess with how you organize your work or your planning. I understand, you know, being a planner myself, I understand that a lot of times planning documents or design documents are very particular to the person. It's particular to how you think. It's particular to how you organize your thoughts and your materials and your activities. But this is really designed to not just help you as teachers, but to also help students and parents. Because, you know, we know that a lot of times, and this doesn't matter what grade level you are, if this applies to elementary, middle, and high, sometimes our lesson plans are written very, you know, very, you know, very are difficult to read for those who are not in education. You know, we write it for other teachers, we write it for ourselves. So a lot of times they contain very specific terminology, they contain statements directly out of the standards, you know, and you know, sometimes it can be very intimidating and just, you know, outright difficult to read for those who are not in education, you know. So, you know, we really want these documents to be very easy to read for the students themselves if they're working independently, as well as for their parents or any other family member who might be helping them with their assignments. So, you know, we're asking that we really try to take some of the resources and some of the language that we already use and kind of change it and write it in a way that, you know, a student who's working independently can understand it, or a family member who's not in education, or, you know, even a family member who may not be familiar with academic work, will be able to understand and to read. So the three parts include the first part, which is just general information and instructions related to the lesson. This includes things like, okay, what are you going to be learning for the week? Describing the, you know, the skill or the knowledge that's going to be included. What activities, you know, giving them a preview of what activities are going to be included. As well as what is going to be in the packet itself, you know. So this gives them a whole preview, a whole introduction to the unit. So the idea is hopefully the students and the parents get an idea of what this, you know, this set of activities are going to be. And again, I know I put the title of week, but this could be a lesson that spans a week or 2 weeks, or, you know, some type of you know, shorter comprehensive type activity that's connected to another set of activities. Part two is the actual content itself, the explanation of the content. So if you have reading material, this is where that would go. The reading material, the videos, if you have PowerPoint slides or if you have handouts, this is where all of the resources would go that the parents would kind of point to. So if you were to send it out there, and let's say you put it in an email, one way I would recommend to do this is that part one be kind of written into a comprehensive document, and then part two, all of the items that are included in part two would either be organized by different types of files or maybe even put into a folder which you would then zip, and then the parents could pull out that zip folder. But again, you know, kind of, you know, make sure that there's a, the way that you do it, try to make it consistent from class to class. And if there's a way that if you guys are able to coordinate this at the school site so that everybody who kind of does this in a similar way, so that the students and parents don't have to figure out 6-7 different, you know, configurations of the folders, you know, I think it would really help the students and it would really help the parents, you know. So anything that you can do to plan this for yourself as well as coordinate it with your colleagues so that the procedures are consistent across the board with your entire school. And you know, I know that a lot of this is something that, you know, eventually if we find best practices out there and things have started to work out well, we can always improve. So don't think that we have to get this perfect the first time around. The intent is to get the school year started and then we can improve over time. And, you know, we're definitely going to ask schools to kind of have some type of internal review and improvement process. And then as we go into more district level sharing, we can share best practices across schools. The third column is kind of describing the activities themselves. So part three is the actual activities for the class. It's the lesson activities and evidence of engagement and learning. So, you know, if you can include a sample recommended schedule, so what would be the schedule? What would the schedule be like for the student engaged in this set of activities? And you know, I have to just kind of kindly, you know, with really respect everyone's kind of view of how they approach their classes. But just as a quick reminder, that these students are taking multiple classes. So especially in elementary school, you have, you know, the same teacher, and you have six classes. You have the five core content areas, and then you have Chamorro. But then also in secondary schools, in middle school, you have seven classes, and in high school, you have six classes. So, you know, don't feel like your class, you have to give students so much work that, you know, it takes up their entire amount of time. I mean, we have to keep in perspective that these students have, you know, in the case of middle school, they have six other classes that they're taking. And in high school, they have five other classes that they're taking. So really, the lessons and activities have to be reasonable in the time frame that is given. And we're looking at, you know, probably weekly and maybe even every 2 weeks where there's a cycle of work that needs to be submitted kind of on a regular basis. So a sample recommended schedule of how to engage with these activities. Then the engaging activities itself, the practice activities, applications and extension activities. So anything that you do to allow the student to interact with the material or practice, you know, a lot of times we're looking at practice, handouts, graphic organizers, worksheets, or the project. So really it's how do the students engage with the materials? It's the presentation of the material initially, and then what are they doing to actually either apply or practice what they're learning. And then, of course, the last part is the evidence of engagement and learning to be submitted to teacher for this unit. So this is basically the grading. So what is it that you're collecting from the students to show that they've learned the material or that they've engaged in the material? Now, we're going to go into more sessions regarding sample evidence of engagement and learning as well as grading. We won't have time to go into that before school year starts. I mean, really, I mean, I know that we're just kind of throwing a lot of information to you guys, but, you know, over the next couple of weeks, we will definitely pull folks together and talk more about what are some examples of how you can assess students' learning and you know what type of evidence can be presented from them, which you could then base your grades on. So here is an example lesson text, and again, I'm not going to go through it in detail with you, but you know that your principal has a copy of this, and administrators, I'm going to give you periodic updates. But this is an example that I created. So, you know, the reason why I was the one that I want to make sure that I was the one who did this is because you know, I want to show how relatively easy this could be. I mean, I haven't been in the classroom for a while, but I still keep up to speed with the strategies in the classroom as well as the standards themselves. So I'm very familiar with the English language arts standards, in particular middle school reading. You know, so I just kind of chose a reading standard, and I wanted to kind of make it something that was general enough that it's a standard that applies to not just reading and English language arts, but it could apply to any content area, and it's definitely valuable. So the skill that I chose was identifying the main idea and summarizing. So some of you, especially those who've been through the classroom instruction that works training, we speak about, you know, summarizing as a major strategy, not just from the part of the teacher as a teaching strategy, but for the students as a learning strategy themselves. Because if they develop the skill of summarizing, they're able to really work towards not just comprehension of the material that they read, but being able to distill the most important pieces of information moving forward from whatever it is they read. So whether it be a passage from literature or whether it be nonfiction text or informational text that they have to read for, you know, another class. I also put in there fluency as, you know, as one of the major skills. So, you know, that's fluency and being able to read correctly, clearly, and with the right speed and feeling is something that every single student can practice while they're at home. If we give them a set of reading material at grade level, or even at grade level, a level above their reading level, it's something that they can practice. It's something that every parent, or brother and sister, can, auntie and uncle, can help a child practice. It's like, if you're a second grader and here is a second grade piece of material, you know, can you practice reading fluently? Because as we all know, reading fluently is really a precursor to being able to comprehend the material for that grade. So here I wrote up this guide question: why is this knowledge or skill important for me to learn? And then this text here is actually text that I wrote, you know. And you know, again, the reason why I wrote it is because I want folks to see how, you know, it's relatively easy. If you're a teacher, a lot of the material that you would say verbally in class, like if you are to start the class off with a lecture, you can actually write that down and make it very easy for parents and families to use. You don't have to photocopy a textbook, or you don't have to pull something off the internet. Just your knowledge about the standards themselves and what you would do will allow you to create your own text. And the beauty of creating your own text is we own it. So everything that, every example that I have here, because it was written by me, we own it as a department, or you own it as a teacher. So I don't have to worry about copyright. I don't have to worry about getting permission from a publisher or a website. This is something that I just created on my own that belongs to me. Now I know I did speak to some of the teachers about this. Is, well, you know, how do you know it's correct? Or how do you know if it's of high quality? Well, that's a perfect example. This is something that I just created on my own. But you don't have to create it on your own individually. You can take this and say, hey, can we pull together five or six teachers and let's read through this? Let's read through this and make sure the text is, number one, correct. Make sure it's written with high quality. And three, make sure it does what I'm asking, you know, that it's understandable to parents and students. So if you're worried about quality, or if you're worried about accuracy, then, you know, don't do it just yourself. I mean, create it, start off with a draft, and then share it with your colleagues so that you can come up with, you know, text that you're comfortable with, that you're familiar with. I mean, this is something that we do on a regular basis. We write reports all the time. We write memos. We write letters. We write so many, we create and generate so many documents in the Department of Education that we already have a process to refine our writing. All I'm saying is apply that same process to the development of curriculum. It's not something that you have to simply do on your own. So here is, I was able to write this text and able to discuss what does each standard mean, what is understanding the main ideas, summarizing, and so on. And then I describe here what the activities are. So that's in the first column. In the second column, I explain that, okay, I have a PowerPoint presentation, I have sample reading passages, and then I have activity sheets that they would follow. And then here in the third column, I tried to give a sample schedule. And again, this is all something that you could definitely improve on. So, by all means, I'm not saying this is a perfect example. I'm just saying, this is a pretty good start if you wanted to just get an idea of what this lesson plan format could look like. Now, the reason why I put it into columns is because I wanted to make sure you saw the relationship between each one of the points or the parts. But you don't necessarily have to put it in columns. You can put it, in rows and put them on top of each other because, especially like, for example, column two, your description might not even take that much space versus in column one, it might take a lot more space. So, putting it in columns might not work from a formatting standpoint, but you could totally play around with it and move it around. The only thing that I recommend is you keep the components and parts so that parents see a consistent format or at least the content so that they're not confused and they don't have to look around for information, especially if it's from teacher to teacher. Also, I know a bunch of you have attended the Microsoft training. So I wanted to just make a few points. We learned this as we were making the hard copies over the summer and at the end of the school year. You may modify as you wish. I mean, I'm a secondary teacher, so I'm not very creative when it comes to like designs and stuff like that. I mean, I'm sure there are other secondary teachers who are way more creative than I am, but I'm more like a straightforward, okay, here's the bullet point number one, bullet point number two. I mean, you see it in my PowerPoint presentations. I mean, you can tell when it's a PowerPoint presentation that I create because you're going to get a title, you're going to get bullet points, and you're going to get text. But then if you see like a lot of graphics, and if you definitely see like things moving on the PowerPoint presentation that I'm doing, then you can guarantee that I was not the one who created that PowerPoint. Somebody did that for me. So that's kind of how my documents that I generate, that I send out to people for workshops. But as a teacher, depending on the grade level you're teaching, you might want to make your handouts and whatnot look a lot more eye-catchy, right? And a lot more visually appealing for students. And I just wanted to say that as we make the hard copies, especially if you're creating stuff with hard copies, you can add graphics by changing the fonts, including additional information or reformatting the template. When selecting graphics or designs, please remember that copies will be made in black and white. So whenever you're making a copy or we're creating hard copies, those are going to be black and white. So not all pictures or designs come out early or in grayscale or black and white. So if we can just go ahead as much as possible, think about it, that it's going to go on a black and white document. And you can change the fonts, you can change the size. So I tried to give you an example down here of how some of these items or some of these strategies can be used or techniques. I changed the font, put some bold. Sometimes you can change the font and italicize. You can use shapes and you can fill in the shapes. Whatever you can do to make the document eye-catchy, is invited. But just keep in mind that if it is going to be something that's copied, it's going to be in black and white. Of course, although it does take an extra step for making something in black and white, and then you're going to also make it in color, especially if it's online, because if you're doing something online, it doesn't necessarily have to be black and white. But, whatever you can do to kind of balance the two. because I hate to say that you have to create one that's in color and then one that's for black and white. I mean, that would be, that's kind of like doubling the work, unless there's a way that you can do that quickly. Just a sample startup schedule and tasks for each models of learning. I just want to remind folks that remember that all curriculum and instruction involves the interaction of three things. It's the curriculum itself. Like, what are you trying to teach? What is the content that is actually trying to be presented to the students? Either it's a knowledge that you're trying to impart, some type of skill, or some type of, you know, disposition, appreciation for something, right? And when you kind of clarify what that is, you know, either through the PSSTs or through a combination of PSSTs or whatnot, then the next part really becomes kind of the instruction part. Is how does the students interact with that information? So you're training them on something or you're teaching them something. How is it that they implement that kind of, you know, as part of their learning? How do they get to practice it? How do they get to utilize it or you know, apply the information? It's like a skill in mathematics, you know, or so forth, right? So it's really the level of engagement that the students have with the material. Now, in the case of the models of learning, of course, it would be different if it's an online student. It would be different if it's a hard copy student, and somewhat different if it's face-to-face. But the idea is the curriculum would be the same, but the instruction and the application would be very different depending on the model of learning. That goes the same for the assessment and the evidence of engagement evidence of learning. Is how are the students going to demonstrate that they've actually learned the material? You know, sometimes it could be through a video, it could be a verbal conversation that you have on the phone, it could be them kind of giving a presentation in audio or a presentation in video, or something that allows them to kind of show that they've learned what you've tried to teach them. And it doesn't have to be just one assessment or one tool. It can be something that's done over time. It can be something that's repeated. And it's something that, you know, really allows them a variety of ways to show you what they've actually achieved. This next section addresses implementation strategies and activities related to teacher proficiency levels. So I tried to put together some guidance having to do with the proficiency levels of teachers with regards to technology. And mind you, when I say proficiency level, this is kind of a self-assessment really on your part. So I tried to put descriptors that could give you an idea of what each level would mean. But then you would have to be the one to decide where you would fall. Right? So this would not be, I don't have a survey, I don't have a assessment instrument to determine where you would be, but just kind of get a feel for some of the activities, and then you would determine where you would be kind of most comfortable placing yourself. Also understand that these different activities and strategies don't necessarily need to be mutually exclusive again, or even kind of progressive. You can kind of mix and match as you see fit. And if there's something that you think is missing, feel free to add, you know, kind of on your own. But this is really just trying to help you think through what are some of the things that you could do at each level, right? So that you don't feel as though it's kind of just an overwhelming rush of things for you to do. So the first level is a proficiency level one. That's the beginner novice level. Maybe you're not familiar with teaching with technology. You're uncomfortable with attempting distance learning strategies. Really just kind of introductory skills. And also keep in mind that when we talk about distance learning strategies, we're talking about distance learning strategies across the board for all three models. So even if a student is not in the online component, or a teacher is not really assigned to teach online courses, we want every teacher to implement some form of distance learning, because students would still have to do a lot of work at home or you know, do some of the work when they're away from school, even in the traditional model. So the beginner novice level is you're not familiar with teaching the technology, maybe uncomfortable. I would recommend that you start off slow. with basic use of technology tools. You'll control your speed here depending on your level of comfort. Now, some teachers, you may have the disposition of you're the type that you just want to jump right in. You know, like, okay, let's just do it. Let's just figure this stuff out as we go. While others are kind of like to dip your toe in like the water before you kind of jump in. I'm kind of in between both. In fact, even myself, you know, my staff is probably laughing at me every time I do this, but I'm really forcing myself to utilize some of the tools that many of them are already proficient in. So I'm just starting to use, you know, Google Docs and, you know, a lot of the Google applications and you know, like these videos, I'm creating these videos and sending them out to people and whatnot, even though I hate recording myself and I hate the sound of my voice. But, you know, I'm really forcing myself to try to utilize some of the strategies that we're expecting teachers and students to eventually use in their classrooms. You can start off with basic email. Oops, okay. Okay, even that's, yeah, I messed that up. But basic email, you know, email groups and exchanging emails with students. So, you know, that could be step one, is just making sure you have every single student's email, making sure that you're able to organize the groups. And maybe sometimes it's just group interaction through email where you're going to start off. Definitely teach them how to use Google Calendar, right? So both from a class standpoint where you can send out information or calendar dates and, you know, due dates and video conference sessions and things like that, plus gives them a skill to also utilize the calendar for themselves. And of course, I think we can all agree that it's not just the Google Calendar piece that's important. It's also the skill of actually organizing things that's really important. Or using the chat features on Google, you know, that is a real simple thing to do. You can set up small chat groups on the side when everyone's online. Maybe start off with some small video conferencing. If you're not comfortable with organizing the entire class, maybe you can do smaller groups of students, so that you're only managing maybe 5 or 6 students at a time versus managing all 20 students. And really, I want you to understand, you know, especially for those teachers who are new or who are just really not comfortable with the technology, don't feel like you need to rush. Start off slow. Remember that online education is really just like regular education. You have the content, you have student interaction with the content, and your methods of assessment. So the tools that I noted here, the chat features, the video conferencing, the calendar, and even just basic emails. These are more than enough to get you started, you know, and once you get comfortable with communicating with your students and interacting with them, kind of in an online environment, you know, gradually you're going to be able to implement and build your confidence and utilize other tools. I do also want to kind of throw in one point, is don't try to just replicate your face-to-face class. If we are simply viewing distance learning as just trying to replicate a face-to-face class in an online environment, then we're really not taking advantage of the online tools that we have available to us. Remember that it's a combination of synchronous versus asynchronous interaction. So there are going to be some times when we are together with the students at the same time, communicating with them at the same time, but a lot of this work is also going to be independent, where they're going to have to do a lot of the work on their own. They're going to have to do it on their own time, which means we have to really teach them how to organize their day, how to organize their work, because they're not just working with your material, they're actually organizing work that has to do with all 6 or all 7, you know, other classes that they're taking. When you are at proficiency level 2, you're at what we call a competent practitioner, right? So you feel competent. You feel like, okay, I got this, right? Feels much more competent with the use of technology. You're willing to try new strategies for distance learning, including the addition and integration of new applications, websites, and other technology tools. So, you know, proficiency level 2, where you feel competent, could be, you know, making sure that you got all the level 1 stuff there. If you feel like you're ready to just jump right in, then just do it. You know, just see what you can do with some of these tools. You know, you might want to start using Google Classroom as your learning management system, Google Classroom. This helps you kind of organize your online work and online material and assignments for your class. You might be much more comfortable with online classroom management. So you're now in the groove of managing your email and managing all your work with your students. And, you know, maybe you're starting to create videos, you know, you're using YouTube, you know, maybe for your own videos, or maybe you're comfortable with selecting videos that you're going to, for YouTube that you're now sharing with your students. Maybe you can incorporate screencasts, kind of like what I'm doing right now, is I'm doing a screencast with Zoom as they're recording this. As you can see, it's Algorito's name, so I'm using Algorito's computer, and I'm recording on his computer, and then he's doing the editing for me. But yeah, something like that, where you're now videotaping yourself, so that this is something that can be shared with your students and at any given time. You can also incorporate other Google apps like Docs, Sheets, Sites, Slides, Google Blog, Drive. So all of the other applications that are available in the Google's school suite is maybe you're now starting to use some of those. Here's another interesting strategy that I think is pretty cool: facilitating small group sessions with students, or allowing students to meet independently for group work or study sessions. This is something that we're actually starting with the school administrators, where, you know, we have a big meeting with school administrators, and then we break them up into smaller groups, and those smaller groups are really organized by themselves. And, you know, it's really simple, because once you put a meeting schedule on the calendar, and if you click Google Meet, it will automatically generate a link to bring everybody together. So everybody who you invite to that particular quote-unquote meeting, all they have to do is, if they want to join the meeting with Google Meet, all they need to do is click on that link, and they are automatically allowed to join. So, you know, some of those strategies can be used with you as a teacher facilitating that, or you can have other students facilitating that on their own, working kind of independently. So it's kind of like taking individualized group work and making it more independent and more asynchronous when it comes to what happens in a class setting. Now, if you're a proficient practitioner, we're considering that level 3, where you feel very comfortable with the technology and distance learning. Regular implementation of a variety of distance learning strategies tries new online and technology tools often, and you're willing to train and support others in using strategies. So you're good to go with level 1, level 2. Try out new applications outside of what is being offered. So there's other applications out there that you're ready to try and use beyond what's being offered through DOE. Or you're very comfortable with the online management of students and utilizing a variety of ways to interact with class and content. So you are really kind of going beyond what, you know, other teachers are just kind of doing as a regular class, and you're really trying to experiment with new ways that you can interact with the students. And the last item is a groove is evident. So you're kind of in your element, you're kind of feeling the flow, and you're kind of moving forward with all of your plans. The advanced level is, wow, if you're kind of at this level, please do whatever you can to help your other teachers. That means you are willing to teach others online and distance learning strategies. You're willing to go beyond what is currently being done in classes in the district. Basically, you're ready for more. You're looking for more. You're in the groove with your students. You're having them do different types of projects. You know, maybe you're having them create videos and doing virtual field trips and just kind of a whole bunch of stuff. I mean, I know some of those things could actually be in level 3, but, you know, it's really totally up to you. And if you're at level 4, you're kind of already moving towards improvement of yourself, as well as you're really kind of a leader in your school, helping your administrators and school leadership teams. So these are some examples of different activities that you can use at each level. And again, remember that these proficiency levels is really a self-assessment on your part. So you decide kind of where you think you fit. These categories are not necessarily mutually exclusive, and, you know, sometimes the activities will definitely overlap. So it's really kind of a decision you have to make with regards to what where you think you would sit and what strategies do you think are most applicable or most that you're most comfortable with. Now here, this last part here is just to kind of help schools prepare for the models of learning at your school site. I'm not going to go through each one of these items line by line because they're already written here in the document. I do ask that you, when you read it separately, you go over this with your administrators, get an idea of what your plans are for the school and help, you know, use this information to help you prepare for your professional development days as well as, you know, how you plan to move forward. But obviously, on your PD days, you'll be reviewing the safety protocols, so take care of all of that stuff. Make sure your teachers know what the safety protocols are. And it's really important that everybody in the school, whether it be staff, faculty, and whoever, know that they play a crucial role in really teaching and reinforcing the safety protocols amongst students, and of course, and each other. I want to emphasize that we really don't want to turn these protocols into something of a disciplinary issue. I know, especially in this heightened mode of anxiety and whatnot related to our health and safety and whatnot, you know, we might have a tendency to be kind of on edge. But we don't want to make matters worse by turning these safety protocols into something of a disciplinary matter where we're, you know, kind of scolding or yelling or, you know, just kind of pushing students in a way where they're not able to feel supported or they feel like they have to kind of fight back or whatever. I mean, just, you know, use whatever skill you can and be as supportive as possible as you implement reinforce the safety strategies with each other as well as students. Finalizing the master schedule, of course, you know, that's a lot of time that you're going to need to be talking with your teachers. And here, finalize the design of your school's model of learning. So this is something that every school is going to have to really work towards clarifying and designing and finalizing. For example, your video conferencing time with students, you know, how is that going to work with your online students? And really, this does have to be consistent from teacher to teacher, because especially in circumstances where there's multiple students in your school, where there's multiple family members in your school, the need for you guys to coordinate online time might be very important to them, especially if they only have one or two or a limited number of computers or devices with their students or their children at home. Also in the high schools, to make sure that your schedules do not conflict with each other with regards to when a particular online class is being conducted or when the video conference is taking place. So really everybody who's teaching online and whatnot should kind of coordinate video conferencing time with the students and try as much as possible to keep that consistent, because eventually that schedule is going to have to be shared with the parents and students so that there's kind of like a regular schedule for video conferencing time. And as we noted in previous documents, the guidance here is basically one video conference, meaning a collective conference with the teacher per class or course per week, with a maximum of three, right? So, you know, keep in mind, in elementary school, that's six classes, right? So you have language arts, writing, reading, math, science, and social studies, and tomorrow. So that's six classes. Middle school, it's seven. High school, it's six. Right, so even if it's just one, you're doing the minimum. That's already six, seven, and six video conferences for the students throughout the week. And if you do the maximum of three, that's already, you know, the highest is 21 for middle school, and then in elementary and high school, it's 18. So really, we have to make sure that, I mean, some families will say that's too much, and some families out there are like, no, that's not enough, because in their minds, everything is synchronous. I mean, the child needs to be in front of a computer from 8 o'clock all the way to 3:30, and that's just not how this is going to work. This cannot be done effectively and efficiently for an entire district. I mean, there has to be a substantial amount of asynchronous work that's done, and the synchronous work that's done has to be coordinated at the school level to make sure that they don't have those scheduling conflicts. So that's an example of what needs to be done at the school site when you're finalizing your models of learning program. This also includes the distribution of hard copies, the copying and distribution of the hard copies. Now, what I've told the schools is to be prepared for the first two months, maybe even 2.5 months of copying your own hard copies, because we are going to procure the services of a printer, and as well as work pull teachers in so that we can develop common lessons. But by the time that's all set up, it's probably going to be 2 months before we get the final contract in for the printers, as well as if we get all the final lesson plans that are going to be common across the district. But you know, I believe that that's a worthwhile wait, because once that's done, we're going to have majority of the hard copy materials prepared and developed, and then we are going to coordinate the printing of those hard copies centrally. So that way, all we do is we send to the schools the hard copies for them to pass out to their parents. But for now, we're asking the schools to be prepared for at least 2 months, maybe 2.5 months of photocopying your own materials for the hard copy component. This would just be for the core content areas, though. So we're looking at the language arts, reading, math, science, and social studies classes. The electives, because they're so particular with the type of work that they do, those are materials that would have to be photocopied at the school site, depending on what the teachers have created for themselves. Also, the technology for traditional face-to-face classes, for the students who are face-to-face, who are in school, because of the amount of technology that's on campus at the time and the lower number of students who are going to be on campus, we really do have an opportunity to maximize technology use on campus. This will really help out also with students turning in assignments or you know, getting assignments and doing work on the computer. So it really lessens the amount of paper that needs to be exchanged on campus. So we're really promoting this and asking schools to try their best to maximize the use of the technology that they currently have at the school sites, to not only minimize the amount of paper that's exchanged on campus, but to also promote the use of technology, as well as to promote the use of technology for distance learning for the students who, you know, when they're not on campus, on the days when they're not scheduled, where they would be doing work online if they have technology and computers. If not, of course, we're going to have to print the material out for them, and then they'll bring it back when they have their courses. Asking you to debrief with teachers who participate in the CNI training series. Give them a chance to share with their colleagues. Remember, a lot of these teachers who attended the training already, it's a quick training. It provided them with a lot of information. We are going to provide video copies of those trainings. We're creating clean copies so that you don't have the questions and you don't have the interruptions like the breaks. So once those videos are created, we're going to send those out so you can use them for additional training. We also recommend that you provide time for grade levels, content areas, so that they can meet regarding the PSSTs, and already have them talking about the possibility of spreading out the units and lessons. So, you know, individual teachers don't necessarily have to create their entire curriculum. They can actually spread that out, because our intent is to bring those teachers together from a district level, and we can share our lessons and units from all schools, and kind of update our website, which is going to contain, you know, common lessons and units for all grade levels, from kinder all the way through eighth grade, for the course of the year. So we want to create a centralized website that has all of those resources that are already available, so you can have your teachers starting that conversation as well. Then, in addition to the grade levels, content areas, and specific subjects, also give the teachers time to discuss the models of learning. So if you have online teachers, hard copy teachers, face-to-face, have them kind of meet together within the model and then amongst the models, so that they can discuss specific strategies and specific things that are needed for each one, so that they're able to collaborate with each other and support each other. And then here, if possible, have them start talking about their strategies that they would use for each of the different models, maybe and try to brainstorm and prepare for the next couple of weeks. Here, I've given some examples about what you could do during your first week. And again, this doesn't have to be the first week. You can take longer than this. I don't think it would be less than a week, but I don't want the schools or the teachers to feel this pressure to immediately start on the academics, because we know that these students have been out of school for a very long time already. And we also know that they've also gone through a very traumatic experience. So we would be very naive in thinking that we can simply jump into the curriculum and the academics without really thinking about their social and emotional health. Also, we know that in person, it's very, very important to build that relationship with our students and their families. We know that even with the online piece and hard copy piece, it's going to be even more important. So I've put together some of these recommendations. I've asked my instructional coaches and some of the teachers over the last couple of months some of the recommendations about how we can build relationships with our families and students. And so we started to put some of these ideas together. So here are some examples. Like, for example, phase one with the online folks, make sure you have their email addresses and confirm the email addresses of students, as well as the email addresses of parents. And I just recently learned this, so I'm kind of excited about this, but some of you may already know, when you use Google Classroom, you can actually invite the parents to participate as well. And the parent will only be able to see their child's work in Google Classroom. The Google Classroom allows both the student interaction as well as the parent interaction as well. So that's also really, really good. Also, use this as an opportunity to update the demographic information that you have so that, you know, phone numbers are up to date, addresses are up to date, and email addresses are up to date. You can provide a welcoming letter and video. And, you know, really, this is a big part too, assessing their capacity for technology. A lot of these families may have access to technology, but they may not have been using the tools that we're going to be using for education. And just because they have computers or tablets or internet connectivity, that doesn't mean they've used it for professional purposes or they've used it for education. So, you know, sometimes they've only used it for entertainment. And it may be a really good system, but they only use it for entertainment or maybe even news. So there needs to be a lot of time that is spent on supporting families with regards to the technology, and finding out, you know, how strong they are with the technology and the utilizing of the different tools that are available to them. The beauty of the Google Suite is that through their email, they have access to all of the tools already. So they can practice on their own. They can practice as they utilize the tools, you know, outside of the classroom as well. And this applies to all three models. So knowing that we want to promote the use of technology across all three models, part of it would also have to be assessing their current technology capabilities and providing those additional supports. With the hard copy folks, you know, a lot of this also is the same thing, but you know, it's also harder because, you know, some of them may not have technology access. Doesn't mean they don't have any technology access at all. It just means it's probably inconsistent and probably not enough for them to utilize the equipment for a full online course. Yeah. Some of the parents also might be choosing hard copies because they have multiple children and only like one computer or a couple of devices. So they want to be able to access those materials on paper. And so with this, please, you know, remember that we are not here to penalize them for not having internet access, but we do want to promote the use of technology as much as possible if they do have that access. With this particular group of families, if they don't have internet access at all, it becomes especially important that you establish some routine for communicating with the families. They may also need some assistance with kind of organizing their schedule. You know, where, you know, how do you schedule independent work at home? Now, of course, this applies across the board through all of the models, but with the home learning hard copy folks, this is the closest we have to what is normally known as homeschooling. In fact, when parents or families ask me, so is it like homeschooling? I said, no, it's not like homeschooling. It's exactly homeschooling. Like, this is, it's pretty straightforward. I mean, it's, you know, the material is really independent work with the parent and the students. And the teachers are really there for not primary instruction. The teachers are there for support. So the instructional materials and the work that's being done is really through the materials that are provided. And then the teacher becomes more of the support. So if you have questions or if you need, you know, guidance on how to proceed, it really, the role is kind of flipped, where the teacher becomes more support. So this is a very challenging model on the part of the families, because a lot of it is going to be independent work. And a lot of times you're only going to have a chance to maybe speak to the teachers once or twice a week, you know, so about, albeit those might be long conversations, you know, but still, I mean, your interaction with the teachers will probably be just once or twice a week for each course that a student is taking. So they are going to need a lot of help with kind of scheduling a routine at their home site. Now, with traditional face-to-face, of course, we want to take advantage as much as possible of the fact that they're face-to-face and they're together with their teacher. So you want to, you know, keep them kind of engaged with each other, you know, take advantage of the opportunity that they have to work with each other. I know it's kind of hard to think of, you know, cooperative learning and, you know, whatnot when you're trying to social distance, but there are ways that you can make the tables and chairs face each other and, you know, remind them that they could be socially distant, but at the same, I'm sorry, physically distant, but at the same time stay socially connected with them. So, you know, anything that you can do to help build that classroom culture of safety, but also connection would be very helpful. Also remind them that this is not, the days that they're not in school are not days off. There should already be some routine where they're actually working with the material that they were introduced to while they were, you know, while they were in school. You know, so there has to be some type of pattern. If they attend class, they have the material, then the next 2 days they're actually working with the material, and then coming to class back on day four, you know, when they're back in the classroom. And also, as I noted earlier, trying to promote the use of the technology in the classroom, since there's more laptops available now and there's less students. We want as much as possible every student to be interacting with the computers while they're at school. And of course, as in the calendar committee, they noted that if schools ever close down or schools are shut down because of, you know, some change in COVID, everybody automatically changes to a home learning model, either home learning online or home learning hard copies. So within your traditional face-to-face folks, there's going to be groups of students who are going to automatically switch over to online or automatically switch over to hard copies whenever schools are closed. And then, of course, all of the traditional teachers automatically switch over to home learning teachers when the schools close down. So that's basically how we will address school closures, kind of when they're sporadic or when they're kind of done, when they're unplanned and done almost immediately. So I think, the last thing I just wanted to kind of emphasize here, and of course there's a lot of kind of recommendations, so, you know, please take the time to look through this. Hopefully, this will help you at least have an idea of what your first week will look like. Again, don't think that this has to be a first week. This can be, you know, depending on how long it takes, it could be a first week, it could be a second week, so on. So really, you know, play it by ear, you know, get feedback from your students, get feedback from your parents, and if more time needs to be spent in certain areas, we can definitely do so. Don't feel like you have to be rushed, and so on. So, I want to thank you for your participation. As you can probably tell, I'm in a restaurant and I'm actually recording this. I'm actually at King's. The earlier half of the video was recorded at Infusion. The second half is recorded at King's. And I was actually in an area where there was like no people. And now this like large group of like 30 teenagers for some reason just walked in, and I can hear them in the background. So this is perfect timing, because it comes to the end of my presentation. I want to thank you again all for your attendance and participation and watching this video. I really hope that it was helpful. I know I'm going to talk to you and see you again before the school year starts, but if I don't see you personally, I just want to wish you well. I want to thank you for the work that you're doing. I know that a lot of you started working on this way before the summer started, and now over the summer, which is supposed to be your vacation for many of you, you're working during your vacation. You know, we're so lucky to have you, and I really think, you know, with our collaborative spirit and with our desire to support each other and our desire to support our students, we're gonna get through this challenge together. So again, thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of your summer. Have a wonderful school year. Adios.